Well, thank you so much. I have to say, I go to a lot of libraries, and Nathan's perhaps the most prepared librarian I have ever met. He's got everything down. I was just telling him he would either be perfect at NASA mission control or maybe the worst job ever for him. I don't know which. But I'm so thankful to be back in Livonia. Nathan in Livonia has had me several times, so I'm always excited to get to come back this way. And I'm always really excited when Nathan will call me up and say, hey, you know, we've got a new topic, or they're looking for something kind of new to present on. Could you come up with something for that? And I usually get, you know, several months heads up. And this was no exception. This was something I was really excited about to tie into the One City, the One Book program. Has anybody been reading along with that so far? Maybe if you just started, I know I'm kind of the opening bookend for that, so hopefully I'll get you excited a little bit about that book. It has to deal with areas, how history impacts the natural environment and things like that, and one of the local natural environments is, of course, the River Rouge. And so I'm going to be talking a little bit tonight about some of the industrial development there, because it certainly has an interesting history in all of Michigan, certainly, especially Southeast Michigan, and the closer you get. I am somebody who I actually worked for a few years as the assistant chief curator for the Dearborn Historical Museum. So I dealt a lot with Dearborn local history, so I was really excited to talk a little bit about Ford and Ford history, because I think it is infinitely fascinating. In fact, the biggest challenge is trying to cram it all into an hour. So we'll dive right in. So when we're talking about the River Rouge, we'll talk about the river in a little bit, but it all starts kind of with Henry Ford, right? We have to talk about Henry Ford. There's no getting around that, because when you talk about businesses that are influenced by one person, Ford has got to be up there as, you know, this guy's ruling this thing. His decisions are what makes everything go with Ford. And to give you guys just a little refresher, I know a lot of people in Michigan know a lot about automotive history. It's one of these things that's ingrained into us, but it's always worth, you know, a little bit of review. Henry Ford was born in Dearborn, not too far from the River Rouge, all the way back in 1863. So to a family of farmers. I always kind of joked when I would show people around the city of Dearborn or even Southeast Michigan, we'd wind up on Ford Road. And I said that Ford Road in Dearborn is like the only thing in Dearborn that's Ford, but it's not named for Henry Ford. It was already called that when he was born. It was the Ford family. They had lived there as farmers for such a long time. So he was born into this kind of farming community, but he was very interested as a young man in some of the work that could be done by machines. He was kind of in the right place at the right time. Famously, this is something I was actually just at the old car show at Greenville Village this last weekend. Saw some great demonstration, some great old cars there, but one of my favorites is the kitchen sink engine they show. This is this very experimental gasoline engine that Ford's experimenting with in 1893. And they did a great job explaining all of it, but I said, you know, if I were telling the story, the one thing they left out is they talk about how, you know, he machined these parts out of plumbing pieces and he had to have his wife come help him, and it was positioned in the kitchen sink because they needed the electricity from the light bulb that was hanging up above to set the engine off. Well, what they didn't really emphasize in their talk was that it was Christmas Eve and they had like a 5-week-old newborn at home, and Henry Ford said, you know what's more important? Come help me run this engine I made in the kitchen sink. So that kind of tells you how driven I think Henry Ford was and how interested he was in these mechanical things. In fact, as a younger man, one of his very first, shortly after marrying Clara, he'd been given a tract of land to go out and clear. He had hired this big industrial steam traction engine that he had kind of learned to run a sawmill to clear the land and saw it. And he was really said, that's where the future is. I don't want to spend time in the farm field. I really hate all this farm work. I don't want to go out and milk cows and pick up the eggs from chickens. I want to work with machinery. And so they actually move into the city of Detroit. Henry and Clara do. They have their kid in 1894. And that's, of course, famously Edsel. I actually do a whole talk on Edsel Ford. It's a pretty cool guy. But Henry would wind up working for the Edison Illuminating Company. That's him up there. And he is quite good at what he does. He's pretty adept at running in all of these big machines, working with all of the equipment. That's where he's getting a lot of those cast-offs to both make his first engine, and then about a year and a half later, his first automobile, the quadricycle, which he's driving around in June of 1896. He had actually met Thomas Edison. Well, he worked for Edison much further down the line, right? He's just working in the local company, but at one point he's taken to New York. He meets Thomas Edison face to face. His boss introduces him and says, you know, Mr. Ford, here's working on a car powered by gasoline. And Thomas Edison, who is Henry Ford's hero, says, I think you're onto something. keep it up. So he does. So he, you know, continues with his work. He actually sells that first quadricycle as kind of a prototype. And by 1897, he's already got this kind of runabout, a much more improved model of that car. And he would actually start the first of several of the car companies that he would be involved with, the Detroit Automobile Company, where they made this little powered wagon delivery vehicle. Well, this company, there's a reason you haven't heard of the Detroit Automobile Company. They almost immediately went out of business. These were not particularly profitable cars. There was always this emphasis, and Henry would run into this a few times early in his career, where a number of the people who were financing things really wanted a quick return in profit and didn't care as much about the engineering as Henry did. Henry found one of the ways to gain more interest in investors as more and more people were building automobiles was to get into racing. So there's him driving his friend Spider Huff hanging off the side of sweepstakes his race car. Winning some of these big races really put his name out there, high profile, as a guy who knew what he was doing with some of these cars. Later on, there's him. He gave up the driving role to people like Barney Oldfeld, who's a bicycle rider, in the 999, this great big, very powerful engine. Not much on style, just an engine and a frame and a couple wheels. But being able to win some of these major races drew the attention of Detroit, and he was able to get a little bit more money. And so he was actually able to start his second automobile company, the Henry Ford Company. This is actually a picture of the factory. But those of you who are mighty astute might notice that actually says Cadillac Motor Car Company. That's because the Henry Ford Company also did not last particularly long. He had a number of investors. Henry Leland came in, wanted to buy him out, and basically forced him out through some political backroom, boardroom maneuverings. And Henry was able to walk away with a little bit of cash. And the rights to still use his name, although the Henry Ford Company was completely reorganized into Ford Motor. In fact, if you look at the very early automobiles, you look at a Ford and a Cadillac from about 1902, right at the same time, you can see those are essentially the same car, right? They have a different power plant. Cadillac put their one-cylinder engine in there, but this would actually be something that Henry would hold a bit of a grudge for later on in life. But fortunately, when they were able to reorganize, third time's the charm, right? That's when we get Ford Motor Company, the one that's still around today. So they would set up their initial production for the Ford Motor Company at the Mack Avenue plant. This is one, if you've been to Greenfield Village, they built like a quarter scale model of this, the kind of gray buildings where you like get on the Model T ride, appropriately enough. Although they weren't actually making any Model Ts at the Mack Avenue plant. They're only there for just a couple of years, getting started with some of the other early Fords that did pretty well. Ford kind of had this rather famous look that he said, you know, if we can engineer a vehicle and we can sell one cheap. There was a couple different approaches to automobiles early on. You know, some companies like Packard, they'd sell you a car that cost more than most people's homes. They saw vehicles as something that was for the elite, the very, very wealthy. Henry Ford said there's a much bigger market untapped, kind of middle-class Americans and those who could afford a car by saving up a little bit. So they would move over to the Paquette Avenue plant. Anybody here been to Paquette? It's now a pretty world-class museum. I'm not surprised to see a lot of hands. We're so close by. This is actually, I think, a National Heritage Site, and I think they were looking to even be on like UNESCO World Heritage Site because it's pretty amazing. You know, the Paquette Avenue plant built as this huge factory, this huge like Victorian factory. This is a very 19th century look at factories. And since we're going to be talking about a factory, it bears looking into just a little bit as well. You know, they've got the great big, I like the big sliding fire doors, but you have these big internal pillars and columns inside that break up the space because they're all needed to hold things like the roof up. So Ford would produce some of their other models at Paquette Avenue, like the R and the S. They would even produce a great big Model K, which had like a six-cylinder engine. Henry would actually argue with, he wasn't technically the company president until like 1906 or 1907. And the company president was this other guy who was a financier, he was by the name of Gray, and very luckily for Henry Ford, Gray dropped dead. And that meant that Henry Ford was able to actually become the president. He said, the first thing we're doing, we're not making a six-cylinder engine anymore. We're going to simplify this. And it was at Paquette in the back room. How many of you have been there recently to maybe see the secret room? That's what they call this, because this was a room they set up upstairs, kind of away from prying eyes, where they would work on a really improved model of all of their vehicles. And that's where they would come up with, famously, the Model T. And this is what's going to make Henry Ford just absolutely cement his legacy. This was a car that not only could it be sold very cheaply, it had a lot of innovations in it. There were everything from, it was very simple. It wasn't maybe as conventional as a lot of other vehicles. It's got this planetary transmission with only a couple of speeds. Different kind of pattern layout, but some things like putting the steering wheel on the left, well, that would prove to be a pretty good idea, and just about everyone would follow Henry Ford's example after that. There were some other innovations like adding molybdenum to the steel that would make this vanadium steel that the car was really flexible. We don't think about that a lot today, our car needing to be very flexible, but if you think about road conditions, and I guess it depends where you drive, there are some streets in Port Huron that it feels like the road conditions are about what they were like in 1908. But having that flexible car is really something that was a big deal. Not having to break an axle or break a frame really led to his car becoming very, very popular. And they offered it in dozens of different styles. Everything from, these are the very rare town car Model Ts, which I've always kind of gotten a kick out of because this is a cheap car. It's like having a Honda Civic limo. You know, you don't, that's not the kind of car you make into a limo, right? You send that for your Lincoln and your Cadillac, but here it is all the same. But of course, kind of that iconic Model T, like touring car, is one of the most popular. There's a reason they voted this the car of the century of the 20th century. And as car production would ramp up at Paquette, a number of things would change. We'll kind of get into that. But the Model T was manufactured between 1908 and 1927, which is really hard to imagine today, the same car being made for decades. Sure, we have cars that use the same name. Like the Honda Civic is actually a great example. Like they've been using that name since the 70s, but there's not going to be too many parts on a 1970 Honda Civic as today. It doesn't look the same or anything like that. While they changed the look of the Model T by the end of the run, this was mechanically and functionally kind of that same car that had been made there. And like I said, Henry Ford's big deal was, here's 10 million of them in an ad, the 10 millionth Ford. That's pretty impressive numbers even today. 295 gets you a brand new touring car. Henry Ford famously would not offer credit to a lot of people. You had to pay in full. I have some suspicions as to why that is. Actually, some of his time in Dearborn when he was out splitting wood, he got ripped off by a neighbor when he's like a teenager. And I think for the rest of his life, he said, I see how that went, because he was actually trying to sue this neighbor in the 1890s for $12 that he got ripped off by. But so no credit for anybody. Again, 10 million to 15 million very, very quickly. So from Paquette Avenue, they realized they constantly needed more space. They needed to ramp up that factory space because that was the key to Ford, was their ability to manufacture so many of these vehicles so quickly and at scale. If you've ever heard, there's benefits to industrial scale, Henry Ford's the guy who proves that. So they actually contact this guy right here. This is Albert Kahn, one of my favorite architects, really famous as an industrial architect. Kahn had actually started doing some factory work for Packard, as we mentioned, one of these other big car companies that's in Detroit. He builds the Packard plant, the one that they've, torn some of the parts down. Sadly, the bridge fell down, this famous, bridge in Detroit. But Packard Motor would influence a lot of the Ford motor plants, and basically all of the automobile factories. They sometimes call them, these big kind of glass houses, because unlike that Paquette plant, which is much more of a 19th century factory, lots of brick, these have much more open spaces, a lot more light that's being let in. And the way that they're designed with these huge open bays would allow you to fit lots and lots of vehicles inside to work on them. Because the way these cars were being manufactured was kind of the same way that buggies have been manufactured, basically one at a time. If we know, again, one thing about Henry Ford, it's that development of that assembly line process that would be so key. So the Highland Park plant is kind of what comes next. So this is in Highland Park. They're building this by 1909, so they actually don't even make all that many Model Ts at Paquette Avenue because they have a much, much bigger. Every time, it's like an order of magnitude larger in terms of the scope and the factory that they're going to build. But they're going to try and put as many of the different parts of this assembly together as possible. The Highland Park plant has kind of a special place in my heart. There's a picture of the administration building, which still stands today, right on Woodward Avenue. I actually did my master's thesis there, and just for fun, at no extra charge, I'll show you a couple of pictures of the inside of that building. Because me and my buddy Kelly, we went inside I, this is now going on actually close to a decade ago, we basically were trying to give some ideas for how to use this building or restore it. They gave us a couple of hard hats and told us, you know, watch your step, don't step on anything that looks like it's going to collapse. And we said, okay. But it was pretty fun to explore some of that building, some of these huge industrial spaces. It's hard to get a grip on just how large they were. There's a tree growing inside, things like that for scale. But the Highland Park plant would become this, again, industrial model for where they're going to assemble these Model Ts at an enormous scale. And when you see the space they have, you see the number they have outside for some of these publicity photos, and they do start off assembling them all kind of right next to each other, but they're able to eventually, using these big gantryways and a couple of different floors, bring all of these parts together and finally culminates in this moving assembly line. You know, the first time they're running it, they're running on like a rope at one end. Eventually they get a continuous chain, which allows them to really vary and control how fast that chain is going, how fast they can produce things, and it drastically cuts how long it takes to make an automobile. Because you finally get people who are just doing one job, rather than somebody, we're all Michiganders here presumably, so we all know about this, it's built right into our heritage of like, that assembly line is what makes a factory work. You do the same job again and again and again, and you get really good at it. You know, if you're putting on a lug nut, or you're attaching the headlights, you do that for every car that comes down the line. And the total time it took for one of these vehicles to be manufactured went from the course of hours to something like 90 minutes to even less than an hour by the end, as they get more and more efficient. And sometimes as they dial up the speed on that assembly line, it comes past you just a little bit faster. And so eventually you get photos like this, where they're able to just turn out thousands and thousands and thousands of cars. That's how you have to do that if you want to get to 15 million cars made for just those Model Ts. And you can see the enormous workforce. There's a great postcard. 25,000 employees outside of the factory. I guess everybody had their lunch break. This one was probably a bit of a wash. As everyone, all right, get in the picture. Did anyone blink? You know, we're going to have our big photo. Now, at this point, they are trying to make as many parts as they can, but they actually have to source out a large number of parts from other manufacturers. And this is why almost all automobile manufacturers were working at this time in the early teens. There are companies famously like Continental. You know, Continental, I think maybe short-lived, might have had tried to assemble their own car, but mostly they just provide engines to other companies who put that Continental engine in their car model. And there were other companies that did some of those things. Fisher Body, for instance, you know, Fisher just makes the bodies, right, for other car companies. And so there were a number of these shareholders at Ford. Two of them are rather famous and rather important to our story. John and Horace in the back seat there. They are the Dodge brothers, because they're sitting not in a Model T, but a Dodge. They were initial stockholders in the Ford company, and it's because they had the factory facilities to make a lot of the parts that were going into the Model T. Well, Henry Ford would eventually come to really kind of hate that decision to have them involved and be stockholders. It would actually lead all the way to a pretty important court case. So one of the issues that Ford had, even after immediately moving to Highland Park, he said, we got to go bigger. We have to go even bigger. I want more of this vertical integration. He said, I don't want to have to rely on outside contractors for parts, because if they slow down or there's a strike at their company that I have no control over, it winds up screwing me over, and I don't have control over that. I don't like doing that. So one of the things that he had initially suggested as early as 1914, 1915, was that he was going to use the enormous dividends that the company was making. They had something like $25 million cash on hand. It's hard saying. Henry Ford didn't particularly like accountants. At one point, he fired the entire accounting department at Ford, and they were paying their bills by measuring how much they weighed and taking a guess at it. Like, this is the level of accounting they were doing at that time, because Henry said, oh, what do accountants do? Well, he's got like $25 million on hand, and he wants to spend all of that into a giant factory in Dearborn, where Henry Ford's from. He says he knows the area, he wants to buy up the land, he'd already started buying up some parcels, and he said that's where they were going to put this River Rouge complex. However, the Dodge brothers were major stockholders, and they said, hold on, you've got $25 million sitting around, we think you should pay us a dividend. All these other years, there's been a dividend on the stock. You should distribute some of that to the stockholders. Specifically John and Horace Dodge. Like, we would have millions of dollars coming to us. And so they would sue Henry Ford. And in fact, this would go all the way to the Supreme Court. where they would argue Henry kind of was really obstinate about the whole thing. I know that will surprise anyone who knows anything about Henry. But he would say that, I just don't want to. Now, if he had made the argument he thought it was better for the company in the long run to invest the money back into the company, he would have been A-OK in the legal run, in the legal world. But the problem was he just said, I don't want to. I don't want to give the Dodgers money. And eventually the Supreme Court ruled, like, no, they're your shareholders. You have an obligation to pay them. And so he was forced to pay a dividend out to them. They got something like $12 million out of the deal. Or I think actually they got like $1.5 and $2 million. And then Henry himself, who was also a major shareholder, he got like $12 million, but he didn't even want to pay himself. He wanted to invest that back into the company. So it was at that point he decided, you know what? He was going to try and find a way to get the entire Ford Motor Company back under his direction. None of these outlying stocks, so that way he could do his projects like the River Rouge and no one could tell him no. So by this point, it's like 1917, 1918 when he's having some of these arguments. The United States was about to enter World War I. Henry Ford is incredibly popular at the time. He's drafted at one point to run for United States Senate, and he just says, I'm not going to run. I mean, you can put my name on the ballot, but I'm not going to do any campaign stops. I'm not going to make any policy announcements. And he comes within like 40,000 votes of winning without even lifting a finger to try. But that's how interested he is in continuing the growth of his business empire. You know, he's not interested in these other things, and he's already a multi-millionaire. So one of his tricks he kind of comes up with, he's pretty clever no matter what you say. He's a good engineer, but one of his ideas to be able to get control of his company back is right about 1918, he actually resigns at the end of the year from Ford Motor Company as the president. He says, you know what, I'm going to start a new company with his son, Edsel. There's them. I think it's very telling that he's just looking much more favorably at the car he built than their 15 millionth Ford behind them or his son. And he says, Edsel can be the new president. I don't know, maybe he's good, maybe he's not. Not my problem. I'm going to start a new company, and we're going to make a car even better than the Model T. Somebody that popular, you hear that happen at a big company, what do you think that's going to do to your stock price when you hear the one guy who's behind it all is just leaving it to his kind of untested son and says, he's done with the Model T. Stock price begins falling quickly, and Henry Ford was able to acquire, he does a buyback. So he's able to buy all of that stock back from people like the Dodge brothers. He gathers it all after crashing the price rather deliberately. You wouldn't think about why would you want to crash your stock price. But he gains control of the company. I love, there's one anecdote, they said he was so happy he did a jig around the offices at Highland Park because he was able to have control of his company again. And so once he has like full control, it's back in the family. He owns all the stock. He gets to do what he wants. He's going to start on his endeavor on the Rouge River. Okay, so the Rouge River, let's talk about that a little bit because we got to go again backwards a little bit to intersect these two stories. The Rouge River gets its name from the French, of course. Monsieur Cadillac comes down from Fort Detroit and he's looking at all of these little rivers and inlets because the River Rouge isn't necessarily a mighty powerful river. It feeds into the Detroit River. And if you actually look from, like, there's a great map from Friends of the Rouge that shows all of the different little tributaries where that watershed goes. So right here through Livonia, if you dump something out into the creek, eventually it'll make its way back into the Rouge and into the Detroit River. So when they find this, this is kind of what it looks like. You know, very natural and very, very small. It was not really a navigable river for much bigger than a canoe. You know, Henry Ford would build Fair Lane. His house is right there on the Rouge. He's actually got some hydroelectric dams to power it. But boy, by the time he is done, he sure is going to change the shape and the nature of the Rouge with this huge factory that you can see is right there where the Rouge is entering out into the Detroit River. And you know, the quality of Rouge goes from a place where you could go on a nice canoe ride to, by 1969, the river catches on fire. That's usually a pretty bad sign. Famously, there have been a couple of rivers that have caught on fire right there in the late 60s that would influence a lot of legislation, but we'll get there when we get there. So to jump back into our story, Henry comes back to his favorite architect, Albert Kahn, says, I want you to build a factory the scale of which no one has ever seen before. And they begin construction by about 1917. They've acquired all of that land. They start throwing up the buildings. Now, one of the very first buildings that actually gets completed is the shipbuilding plant. You might think, well, why is he building ships? Well, there were a number of things that they wanted to build right there on the Rouge, and this building kind of got pressed into service because in 1917, outside of the United States, in Europe, the rest of the world is at war. There's a terrible menace on the seas. It's German U-boats, and everyone's very scared of these U-boats, what they're going to do, any Allied shippings. By April of 1917, the United States had entered the war. Now, Henry had famously been very vocal pacifist. He, in fact, led a really ill-fated ship called the Oscar II, where he thought that he could just sail over to Europe and say, all right, I'm going over December 5th, I'll have the boys home by Christmas. He literally thought that for a little bit. He actually gets really sick on the ship and just comes back home. So he was a pacifist, but as soon as the United States had entered the war, he said, all right, well, if we're in it, we're in it to win it. I'm gonna do anything I can with my powers to help us win the world war that we're involved in. And so they would start building ships. And these got called eagle boats because they said they would fly like an eagle over the water looking for prey, like the underwater submarines. They were going to use a new invention. Sonar had just been really rudimentarily invented. And he said, I'm going to build them just like I do my cars on a big assembly line. You know, I'm going to pump out a couple hundred of them. So the U.S. Navy Department says, well, get started on them and build what you can as quickly as you can because we need them very, very fast. Little did they know, the war would actually be over by the time they had finished only like two or three of these ships. But I mean, they started right away. They had already laid down the keel for one of these submarine hunting vessels before the building roof was completely completed. So they're building at one end and still finishing the building at the other end of the assembly line. While they were able to complete three before the war ended, they didn't see any service. They completed an additional 40 or 50 or so. Some of them were used for training. Most of them were scrapped by the time of the Second World War as the design was just kind of obsolete. But Henry Ford then got a really good chance. He got a lot of government contract money to build some of these buildings to flesh out this shipbuilding facility right on the Rouge River. So he uses some of that money to, again, kickstart the building of the Rouge. So they're still pumping out Model Ts, like by the millions over at Highland Park while this is happening, and the Rouge is starting to spring up. So some of the first buildings that you're going to see there are some of the most important. There's some of the iconic ones. You see all the smokestacks there from the power plants that they need a great big power facility to power this giant factory. They're going to need the steel foundries. That shipbuilding plant was one of the first. Henry Ford was really interested in vertical integration, this idea that if he controlled every step of the process, no one else would A, have control, and B, no one else could, you know, gouge him on a price or be unreliable in some way. If he just controlled all of it, he would know that it could run on time. So there's things like the Ford fleet. You know, he knows that he needs to bring in raw materials on the Detroit River and into the Rouge River, so he builds his own freighters, things like the Benson Ford, Henry Ford II, he builds his own lake fleet to bring things into this factory specifically. He knows some of those raw materials that he's going to need. So rather than, again, rely on others, he has mines in West Virginia. He has mines famously in the UP, where this one is, where he is able to mine the iron ore. It's actually Ford engineers who come up with this idea of taking this taconite, coating it in this kind of clay-like material that will all burn off once they put it into the great big blast furnaces, but this makes it a whole lot easier to ship. So he owns those. Henry really likes the Upper Peninsula. He does a lot of traveling in some of his spare time. He heads up that way. And he notices there's a lot of resources there, a lot of opportunities. He sets up his own sawmills that are going to be used for all of the wood that goes into things like Model Ts. You can see one of those Ford sawmills up in the UP that, of course, will then load that wood onto Ford boats to bring it to the Ford factory. Henry's always also looking for ways to make money on these side ventures. He's all about eliminating as much waste as things as possible. He actually has one of his employees that's overseeing the sawmill. He's actually a guy by the name of Kingsford. So you've probably heard what they would turn things in. They found a way to turn their sawdust and leftovers into charcoal briquettes, which eventually you could buy one of those at your Ford dealership, a bag of Ford charcoal to have, you know, a celebratory picnic with your new car. And eventually that spun off into, you know, Kingsford. But there was one resource that Henry had a hard time acquiring anywhere here in the United States that every car is going to need. What's that tire made out of? Rubber. Fortunately, for a long time, you probably recognize at least two of the three people in this picture. So you got Henry Ford, Thomas Edison, and that's Harvey Firestone. So Harvey Firestone's one of these buddies with Henry Ford. They have a really long history. It's why Ford had Firestone tires for such a long time. But even though they're good friends and they had this relationship that had developed over decades, Henry was still interested in trying to procure his own rubber. So there was an experimental community where Henry Ford said, well, they grow rubber somewhere. He looks it up. He says, well, it says they grow rubber in Brazil. I'll buy a bunch of Brazil and we'll have our own rubber plantation. And he actually tries to build a little American town down in the middle of Brazil. This is kind of all that's left of it. It was a spectacular failure of Fordlandia in the middle of the Brazilian Amazon. But that's the kind of guy of bring all of these resources in to the same factory, to the centralized location in Dearborn. Now, to say that the factory, one of the things that's kind of a common misconception, to think that 100% of the materials needed to make a vehicle at the Rouge plant, say a Model A, were all built at the Rouge plant. A vast majority of them were, but there was still a tiny bit of decentralization. Some of that came in the form of the Ford Village Industries. Anybody ever heard of the Village Industries? Maybe been to places. They're all over like Southeast Michigan. There's a few others spread throughout. But things like Nankin Mills. Anybody here been in Nankin Mills? You know, that's not too far. That's a great example. Henry not only liked these small companies, he liked seeing things like water wheels, but he would use them for practical purposes. If there was one small part or something that could be manufactured there, he also was really interested in giving jobs to people who might not have been able to work at the River Rouge. There was a great photo I saw the other day of a bunch of blind men who had been shown how to assemble valve covers. Like they're doing this work that they could be still productive in some way, and Henry always looked for ways to do that, especially after World War I. There were a lot of guys who came home who were, you know, missing limbs, missing arms or fingers, things like that. Those were the kind of places where they could get a job. So those things would still make their way into the Rouge, but the vast majority of products that were needed to make a new car, the raw materials come into one side of the River Rouge plant, and the finished vehicles come out the other side. So the Rouge was rather uniquely sited because not only does it have access to rail lines, roadways, the river itself, the Detroit River, onto the Great Lakes, there were all sorts of different ways of connecting this. And it's hard to imagine just how big the Rouge got, that there were a number of divisions that would be businesses in and of their own whole right. At one point, Henry Ford buys the Detroit Toledo and Ironton, DT&I Railway, because he said, I want my own railroad to connect to the railroad system to move things around at the Rouge, get them out to other parts of the country. It was the largest privately owned railroad in the world because it was just Henry Ford's. He just owned it. At one point, he found it was being very inefficient. When he bought these trains, they weren't necessarily very well taken care of, and he wanted to convert a lot of them to electricity because he said, well, I already have my own electrical plant. I can power these trains on electricity. So you've probably seen these around Dearborn, these big arches. They're the vestiges of that electrification attempt. Eventually, they would go to diesels, so they wouldn't need the electricity anymore. But there were also a number of steam trains that Henry Ford would purchase, and these steam trains were really interesting. They would run just on the campus, the like 1,500 acres or so of the River Rouge, shuttling things around as all of these raw materials were coming in, and things that would have to go from one factory kind of to the next factory, the next phase in that process. And so there were some of them. This one's number 45, but number 29 I thought was really interesting. It's the same kind of steam locomotive, but it was actually a fireless. They called it the tea kettle, because it would actually park next to the power plant and they would load it up with the hot water and the steam pressure it would need to operate for 8 hours. Because of course, you know, steam engines working on, you build up steam pressure inside with a fire. The problem is if you have a fire, you've got all that smoke and exhaust. They needed a train that could go inside some of these buildings to pick stuff up, and they didn't want to fill the entire inside with exhaust. So they had one that they could just pressurize and they didn't have to have a fire inside. So that was their tea kettle. Amazingly enough, so if you've got trains, that means you have to have an entire train yard. You've got a number of men who are dedicated just to taking care of the trains. And not only do they take care of all those trains, Henry Ford buys a lot of like old timey trains for fun, in the way that somebody else might have like a little hobby project of picking up an old car. Henry Ford would be like, oh, I want to restore that locomotive. probably all been to Greenfield Village, or you've been to the Henry Ford and seen that massive collection of steam trains. And he would have his own train servicing department. It could easily have been its own whole business, but this is just to service the Rouge. Interestingly, the trains that Ford is running at the River Rouge were considered incredibly impressive. Henry said that he paid a premium to any of the railway workers who worked there because he wanted the best of the best. He wanted people who would take care of his trains. He went so far as that these trains were getting washed like once a month. They were getting a full wash, wipe down. They'd keep them immaculately clean. Some of those earlier trains and predate these, those steam locomotives, every single thing that the engineers could touch was chrome plated. Because Henry Ford's got a big chrome plating facility. He said that will keep things nice and shiny and clean and encourage these workers to take a lot of pride in their work. So they had the best looking trains anywhere in the country were the ones that were just confined to the River Rouge campus shuttling things around. But you can see it would just continue to grow and continue to grow. Again, probably the most iconic building of the Rouge plant is that power plant with all those smokestacks right there in the middle. You can see the slipway there. But there was a whole series of steps that you would go through at the Rouge plant as these buildings are springing up kind of one by one as they're still working on Paquette all throughout the 1920s. Things like the smelters and the big forges. This is where they would take in raw material to these blast furnaces to make the iron and the steel that they would need for the future cars. They could actually push in, you know, like a crushed up cube of a car into one of these blast furnaces, along with the other iron ore that would be coming in to turn that into the steel they need. That's, you know, as raw as it gets. I really enjoyed that they actually named some of the blast furnaces. The first one was named, appropriately enough, Henry. And then they named the next one Benson, which was Henry Ford's grandson. One of the other great anecdotes I read about was when they were lighting up the Benson blast furnace for the first time. You know, it's this kind of a big ceremony. It's a huge investment. It's going to run for decades and decades and decades. Henry brings Benson, who's like a year and a half, and they keep giving him lit matches to like throw into like a bunch of gasoline-soaked rags around the base of this. He's like, well, we want Benson. It's named for him. Give the kid some matches to throw at it. I don't know. It's kind of fun. But so you've got the blast furnaces. And that was generally considered kind of the worst place to work at the Rouge. It was the hottest. It was the hardest work. That's primarily where the largest concentration of black workers worked. You know, they're kind of given the short end of the stick. Say you can work in the blast furnace. It's definitely the most dangerous place to work as well with all the molten steel. But that's where everything starts. You know, that's going to be sent off to then stamping plants to stamp out the metal components. But there were other whole huge factories. This one's beautiful from kind of an architectural dimension as well. This is the glass plant. If you think about all the glass that's needed in an automobile, there are these amazing pictures. You can see the giant kind of cantilevered pieces on top that open because there's a huge amount of heat that is put out when manufacturing glass, and they would have this in huge long strips that they could cut out. Ford was actually the first company that could actually manufacture safety glass in enormous quantities, an eighth of an inch thick. So that's a couple of glass panes sheeted in between. There's another material like a cellulose that's in between that would keep it from just turning into like plate glass. You know, if you were back riding in a car in, you know, 1905 or something like that, and you get thrown through the windshield, well, it's like being thrown through a plate glass window. It's going to cut you to ribbons. The safety glass, you know, would crack, and you know, certainly, you know, something you don't want to rub your hand on, but it's not going to cut you to ribbons quite the same way. So the Rouge plant, as these various factories are coming online that make up this complex, they're starting to supply more and more of the materials are going over to Highland Park. That's where they're making the Model T. By 1927, the Model T is ancient. You know, there's the basic design that it's all built around. It was designed in 1907 to put into production in 1908. So it's 20 years out of date. And in the automotive world, especially the early automotive world, they're making so many changes so quickly that that's completely out of date. So finally, Edsel's able to convince Henry and many of his other advisors to make some updates. And of course, that's when we get the Model A. And the Model A would be the first car that would be completely manufactured at the Rouge plant. They'd shut down Highland Park. They actually moved tractor manufacturing over there. And the Rouge plant would retool for the Model A. And that's when they'd start pumping that out. by 1928, 29, 30, and 31 are the 4 years for the Model A. So Edsel is a really interesting key player. Again, he's nominally the president of Ford Motor by this time, but he still kind of does what the old man says, right? But Edsel is really interested in style. He's interested in maybe a higher-end clientele, what they could do to improve the vehicles. He was not just interested in making the same Model T. Edsel would be instrumental in suggesting things like, we should buy the Lincoln Car Company from Henry Leland, that guy who like screwed you over with Cadillac back in 1903. You could buy his company now. Won't that feel great? And also, now we get a high-end car to play with. We can sell that to a higher clientele. It doesn't always have to be the cheapest. But one of the other things that's kind of unique about Edsel is Edsel was also a real patron of the arts. He really enjoyed lots of different arts. He's like very literally a patron of the DIA. He funded it with a lot of money. And the DIA was actually able to bring, starting in 1932, Diego Rivera in. Who did these very famous murals. How many of you have seen the murals at the DA? Hopefully just about everybody, because they are world class, right, to see these. And what do they depict? They depict work at the Rouge plant, which I think is really interesting in very stylized, but that's what they're showing on these huge walls is the work at the Rouge plant. And there's kind of like a dichotomy with them. So there's, you know, on one side it's showing kind of more unpleasant work. On the other side, it's like a racially diverse group of guys who are all pulling in the same direction. They're all working at the same time. You can see, again, kind of a close-up. And there are these different sectors of this mural to take it all in of all of the different jobs. Now, by this point, they're actually working on the Ford V8, this venerable engine that they're going to make for a couple of decades. But you can see them working at the different parts on the assembly line. I always like this kind of an Easter egg that he painted that's probably Albert Kahn, or at least maybe supposed to be Albert Kahn, the architect of the building, is there working on the assembly line, like sticking valves in or something like that. But again, we can see, you know, the huge multi-levels of this factory, the rails where things are coming by, pieces of transmission, parts of the engine block. That's where it's all finally getting assembled onto the frame there at what would be called the Dearborn Assembly Building. So this was just gargantuan. By the time this is fully online in the 1930s, there are 100,000 workers at the Dearborn River Rouge complex. That is a factory that's just unbelievable in scale today, absolutely. By comparison, today at River Rouge, there's like 6,000 people who work there. And that really shows you how far that we've come. But 100,000 workers, they had 5,000 people whose sole job was emptying trash cans. They were keeping the place clean, painted. They're going around doing that kind of work. Every kind of job that you could imagine. There was a laundry service of, you know, a couple hundred people who were going to be washing coveralls, they're going to be washing things, sewing them, mending them. This was a self-sustaining city unto itself where all of these people were coming together. But of course, by the 1930s, we've also run into the Great Depression. And you know, Henry had been able to attract a lot of people to his factories back in the 1920s with the promise of the $5 workday. That came with a lot of stipulations. By the 1930s, there were frequent layoffs, no guarantee you'd get your job back. And labor relations were not exactly great. A lot of people were pretty unhappy, especially during the Great Depression. If you lose your income, you lose your ability to support your family. There are some pretty downright gruesome incidents. One particularly famous one is the Ford Hunger March in 1932 at the depths of the Depression, where several thousand workers marched onto the, they marched from Detroit, and they were marching into Dearborn. They were just demanding food or jobs or both. They wanted something because they said, we can't continue to live like this. And by the time they actually got to the Dearborn city line, they're crossing the Fort Street Bridge, they encountered Dearborn police and Ford security, which at that time might as well have been the same thing. Ford really ran the town at that time. And there's kind of some arguing going back and forth. A couple protesters get, you know, hit with some clubs. All of a sudden, a rock comes out of the crowd and hits one of the cops. The cops start shooting. Five of the protesters are killed, and dozens more are wounded when several of the cops are firing like Thompson submachine guns into this crowd of thousands of people who are trying to march onto the Dearborn campus. So you can see here, four died. One would die actually the next day after this paper, but tear gas bombs hurled. This was, you know, not a great day at the Dearborn plant. And labor would really use this as, this is where the tide really started to shift against Henry Ford as this hero of the working man to somebody who's like, yeah, no, he's a billionaire at the cost of the workers and the conditions that they are put in. One of the most famous features of the Rouge plant is right here. It's actually an overpass. That's the Miller Road overpass. So you've got 100,000 guys a day. They're all having to cross over this overpass to get into the factory. So as you might imagine, this is a place where it's really popular for union agitators, guys who are trying to band together, starting these early concepts of what would become the UAW. Different agitators from AFL-CIO would hand out literature. They'd hand out union cards. They'd try and get people on board with organizing, because they know this is a bottleneck where everyone is passing through that bridge. So very famously, by 1937, you have what's called the Battle of the Overpass. This is probably a picture many of you have seen before. It's really pretty famous because there's, you know, Walter Reuther, a couple of the other guys from the UAW who are there to hand out information, and they get approached by like the gooniest looking Ford goons you've ever seen, who show up to rough them up and give them what for. In fact, there were a number of members of the press there, and all of them had their cameras destroyed, except for one guy who took the photographic plates out of his camera and he hid them under the seat of his car and gave him a blank plate to smash up on the ground. So that's how he was able to smuggle out like these pictures of these guys being hurt. You know, Walter Reuther got his jacket pulled over his head and they just start punching his face. They tipped a couple guys over the side of this enormous overpass. And you know, all pandemonium broke loose. And you see what it looks like when the Ford anti-union guys are beating up these people who are trying to organize. And this really tips the favor in terms of organized labor. People become very sympathetic to that movement. And so as a result, Ford would actually be the last of the big three to unionize, but they still unionized. You know, that was 1937, that Battle of the Overpass. By 1941, Ford was the last holdout on allowing the UAW in there. There were a couple of strikes. Some of them were pretty violent. You can see this one. Some strikers have flipped a nice Ford onto its side. And it was a pretty... You can see here, you know, why did Ford get a Nazi medal? That's a great question, right? So I think that's worth maybe a slight dive into. Because one of the other things that they were doing at the Rouge, Henry Ford, when he had worked on the Rouge, he'd concentrated everything back in Dearborn. He had actually purchased a local newspaper in Dearborn that had been a weekly called the Dearborn Independent. He wound up using it as his anti-Semitic rag. He didn't really write any of the articles, but he certainly read them, approved of them, hired people who would come and write them onto his staff. He published something called the Protocols of the Elder of Zion, this very anti-Semitic myth that like Jews secretly control the world that Henry Ford was obsessed with, this idea. And so he wanted to propagate this. A lot of people are like, hey, I just want to buy a car, man. Why are you giving me this kind of newsletter that's coming with it? But Henry Ford's anti-Semitism would ultimately lead to receiving a medal from Hitler in 1938 from the Third Reich. And Henry kind of knew where that was coming. That was the consulate from, I think, Cleveland and from Detroit, met him on his 75th birthday to award him the highest award that a non-German could receive from the Third Reich. And so as a result, this actually kind of has an impact on the Rouge plant itself, because not only is that anti-Semitism coming out of there, but people like Albert Kahn, the architect who had designed the buildings, was Jewish. And Albert Kahn, once Henry Ford started publishing that stuff, Albert Kahn said, I'm not going in the buildings anymore. You know, he'd still take some of the business because he knew how much it meant to his firm and his employees, and they needed the work. But he personally would no longer meet with Henry Ford to go over some of those building designs. But the late 30s, the early 40s was a very turbulent time as the United States was just a year away from entering World War II. And World War II had already broken out in Europe. And as a result, the Roosevelt administration had really put their thumb onto Ford and said, you got to accept this UAW, you got to let it come in. And so they would come in, they would organize about 6 months before Pearl Harbor at Ford, at the River Rouge, and they created the Local 600, which we'll talk about, which you talk about a local union having a lot of power. There were 100,000 members of the Local 600. It was one of the most powerful organizations in the whole state as the local union, let alone the union as a larger organization as well. But with the coming of World War II, I always like showing these off because I just think they're cool looking. Everyone switches to wartime production. No more civilian cars. It's all about production. Still more production. Bowl them over with more production. Yeah, your production. Beat your promise. More, 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 more. Like, they really kind of hit you over the head with a lot of these. This is one of my favorites. Just pour it on. Because Allied Productions was going to ultimately win World War II, those strategic decisions. Now, the most famous thing that Ford would make during World War II is probably airplanes, B-24s. But that's famously built at another new factory over at Willow Run. However, at the Rouge, because they could retool relatively quickly, they actually slapped up another couple of buildings. One of the very first ones was one building aircraft engines. What's really interesting about this aircraft manufacturing plant, in the same way that Albert Kahn had revolutionized what a factory was with the Packard plant back in 1903, the great big windows, lots of fresh air, by the 1940s, there had been some advancements in technology. This building was designed, even though they knew like German planes couldn't get to us or anything, this was designed to be a blackout plant. There's no windows on this factory. They had great big like fluorescent lighting up here. There was actually air conditioning in parts of the factory, as much to make the machines work smoothly and keep within their tolerances. And they also realized the benefit to making some of your workers a little bit more comfortable. And so this kind of factory, that airplane engine factory that Ford would actually buy from the federal government at the end of the war, would set a new paradigm for what factories would look like in the post-war world. They would wind up making tanks at Ford. They made a large number of those for export. They also made tank engines at the Rouge. And they also made tractors. They were making a large number of tractors because we don't think about, if there's one theme, it's all the things that go into a complex organization like this. Tractors can be just as important as tanks. But again, the whole facility would operate just like they were with their manufacturing cars, where the raw materials are coming in these series of smaller factories, the rail yard that connects them all, everything can very quickly and efficiently move from one factory to the next, and everything's right there on hand because it's highly, highly centralized. By the end of the war, they're ready to make cars again, civilian cars, and everyone's clamoring for one. Now there is a big change, 1947. Henry Ford would die. The old man would die. His son, Edsel, had actually died in 1943. Henry had to come back briefly to take over the company. But when he died in 1947, you'll notice Henry Ford's last ride was in a Packard, not a Ford, but appropriate enough for somebody worth, you know, billions of dollars. And interestingly, they actually shut down the lines at the River Rouge in honor of Henry's death as a moment of recognition. They shut all of the lines down for 60 seconds. They calculated it cost the Ford Motor Company $1.7 million to do that in 1947. That's $24 million today to shut down the factory for 60 seconds. So that shows you how important it is to keep this thing running 24/7 with the scale that it can pump out. They would continue making cars. They had a great big hit in 1949 with the slab-sided shoebox Fords were very, very popular. Those were a huge production run, so they did really, really well at the Rouge. Later on, they would tool up by 1958 for kind of a failure, swing and a miss, right, with the Edsel that didn't do particularly well. But even by the late 50s, things had begun to change. There was actually a little bit of decentralization for the first time. As the old man's gone, Hank the Deuce, Henry Ford II's in charge, they would build Ford World Headquarters not at the River Rouge facility where the administration buildings had been before that, but down the street. They built it away. So the guys in the white collars, they're not going to be at the Rouge anymore. They're going to be down the street. They're close. You can see it from the top floor, I'm sure, but they're not right there. They would begin building other factories that weren't quite at the Rouge. They realized there were some advantages to distributing things and not having everything at the same place. One was Livonia transmission plant. Throw it out to Livonia, right? So that comes about at this time. They didn't just expand upon the transmission plant at the River Rouge. They said, we're going to build a whole new facility somewhere else. One of the biggest hits for the Rouge factory, of course, comes with the pony cars and the Mustang. They're going to pump out so many Mustangs from the River Rouge plant as this would go on and on. Now, we're getting into the 60s, and I've got less and less to say, but maybe less details the closer we get into like living memory, because some of this is going to be pretty familiar to some of us today. You know, we're just past 50 years, the Clean Water Act. If we want to talk about the Rouge itself, you know, the Rouge would actually be subject to some flood controls from the Army Corps of Engineers. So it's in the late 60s that they would actually put in the concrete embankments. It would be a complete flood control, but it was a complete environmental disaster for the Rouge. That's not very natural at all. That's like a swimming pool, like the worst kind of swimming pool ever. You would not want to swim in this. The pollution controls at the Rouge plant for places like the steel production specifically were just so horrendous. By, like I said, 1969, so many chemicals had leaked into the Rouge. It's unclear exactly how the fire started, but it spread pretty quickly out of control, and it was burning oil, gasoline, other chemicals that were floating just below the surface of the water. So even when, I think something like 14 fire departments responded to this, it was actually a local tug that had a hose on it, was able to do the most, but they just had to let it burn out because it was already on a river. How do you put a fire out that's already in the water? More water was not helping them at all in that instance. And it was, you know, shortly after this, by 1970, that they would sign the Clean Water Act, regulating a lot of what was being dumped into water. Richard Nixon would also sign in the Environmental Protection Act. And so this is one of the things that a lot of people said looked like it was going to be the downfall of the Rouge. Production began, they started laying more people off, as for a number of factors. They were concerned about, again, the pollution that the plant was putting out. There was concern about the UAW, believe it or not. They said the Local 600 that serves the Rouge plant was the most radical chapter of the entire UAW. Some people said, you know, the whole thing was full of communists. And they said that they wanted to try and reduce the power of this local by literally just cutting jobs in the Rouge. Send them elsewhere. And the less people that are a member of this local chapter, the less power it has. But believe it or not, this chapter had enough power to influence decisions by Ford Motor. They were one of the big ones pushing for the bring back of the Mustang. They, you know, were championing things like the Mustang 2 and some of the other things that were going to be able to come to the plant. Now, Mustang 2 didn't do so hot, but by the third and fourth generation of Mustangs, that was the only thing keeping the Rouge operating in the 80s and 90s. That was a time by the 1970s and 80s where the American auto industry in particular was really being impacted by Japanese auto sales. As foreign cars, restrictions were lifted, more foreign cars were coming onto the market. Quality just seemed to be far better. This quality had really started to slip at the Rouge by this point. Some of the machines were old, some of the factory processes were old. People felt really comfortable in their position. There's a reason you don't want, you know, one of those Friday afternoon cars, right? It's just not going to be as good of quality because people felt like they didn't need to care as much. It's kind of ironic, this is Mr. Toyota himself. He copied a lot of the design of the Japanese car factories from the River Rouge when they had toured through that auto facility. Ford would even buy a large stake in Mazda and begin manufacturing parts that could be used on Mazdas at the Rouge plant as well in the 1980s. But a large increase in the amount of automation would further cut down the number of jobs needed. If you can have a factory do something more precisely, let me tell you, those robots, they don't do jobby nooner, right? So like, they're there every single day, they don't make mistakes, they're never tired, they're always going to be able to turn out that consistency. But it means that there are less jobs on the line. In fact, interestingly, one of the hallmarks of the Rouge plant had always been the Rouge tour. Right from the time that they opened, you could go and get a factory tour. It's actually part of this picture. If you look in the mural, all these people who are like nicely dressed back here, they're on a tour. I love this kid, by the way, in the beanie. He's like my favorite kid. But they are, they're on a Ford tour in the 1930s to come see this because Ford considered it their crown jewel. They were proud of the factory. By 1980, they had discontinued the tours. They said, we don't want people in here anymore. So it really, really changed. But a lot of that would kind of further change again as there was a bit of an upswing. That's kind of the nadir for the Rouge plant. And as things make their way back up, some of the things that would change, for instance, the way that this is hauling molten steel. These are highly insulated rail cars that would haul things back and forth. Really, really outdated. So they would actually get new blast furnaces. They were so unsafe that they would start new ones. And they actually started to spin off some of these companies. Ford realized that they could make more money by distributing things rather than fully concentrating everything. This had become so complex to build a car. It was always impossible to do everything yourself. They realized it was losing some of that efficiency. So they would eventually spin off the steel plant into Rouge Steel. It became AK Steel. So there's still a steel factory there today, but that was a large portion of the campus at the River Rouge complex. There were some things that were other big changes, things like the invention of OSHA. The Occupational Safety and Health Administration. You know, we always kind of think of OSHA today, I think sometimes is the punchline of like, oh, somebody call OSHA, because that doesn't look particularly safe, right? So there are a lot of instances like that, and that would also further reduce maybe some of the efficiency at the cost of safety at the plant. They spun off the trains, Canadian National. There weren't any more Ford trains or any of this Ford railway that would operate within the River Rouge plant. They realized it was cheaper to leave that to train experts rather than try and be an expert at absolutely everything. Again, in the 1990s, the Mustangs are the only thing that's keeping the Rouge open as they reduce the efficiency, reduce the number of employees that are there. But the UAW fought hard. They said, save the Mustang, which really said, you know, save the Rouge. That's what it was really meaning. The Rouge would also see a real change in the way that things were operating with. They were adopting a policy that the Japanese had kind of pioneered called just-in-time manufacturing. And the idea was it was more efficient to always have things arrive basically just in time. You don't have to have storage facilities that way. You can have a decentralized factory industry, but using things like computers, you can time everything. That stuff gets there just in time, and you don't have to have that holding facility. So they realized that sometimes semis were beating the trains, and so a lot more semis were being used than the trains to haul things in and out of the factory. We all know that there can be flaws with that just-in-time manufacturing. We all went through the pandemic and COVID, and you know it takes kind of one hiccup, and then, boy, it backs everything up. But if you get it running smoothly, this can be a very efficient process, and that's what Ford was transitioning to at that time. Now, I mentioned before, you know, OSHA is sometimes a joke, but sometimes it's not. There's one of the most tragic incidents in the history of the Rouge plant comes in 1999. And there was an explosion and a fire at the power plant that wound up killing six workers. The power plant was, you know, really pretty outdated. They were already looking at building a new one, but kept this running. They said safety was really getting kind of lax. They weren't doing as many requirements for the testing and checking of things to make sure that they were safe. They said a lot of these guys have like mental checklists. And that can work for old timers, but they said, no, we really have to be more rigorous in this. And so there's a picture of the ambulances waiting because dozens of people were burned in this really tragic incident. And even though that was, in some ways, the most iconic building of the entire Rouge facility, you know, it was demolished in favor of a new plan. But a silver lining to that is that they really then said, we need to re-envision what the Rouge plant is. And today, when we think about the Rouge plant, it is once again back on that cutting edge of factories. The reinvestment that's gone on there, this is a great kind of rendering of what the campus would look like, and it's really not too far off. They've got famously that green roof. Has anybody here been on the Rouge tour since they reopened it in 2004? So yeah, it was gone for many, many years, but finally that, again, tells you a lot about it, even just there. The fact that they wanted people to come back in and see their factory again. And while things like the pony cars had always made up a bulk of their production, by 2004, I think it's 2003, it's the Ford F-Series, the F-150s and more that are coming off the line there, because that also shows you a real shift in automotive culture of what cars are valuable to make, what has the high profit margins. Oh, it's these trucks here at the Ford Rouge Center. They make a lot of money. They don't cost a whole lot more than a car to make, but you can sell them for a whole lot more. So these are very, very popular. There's a reason like the F-150 is like the most popular selling vehicle in the United States. And so it's really been bringing the Rouge back. Now the Rouge would be unrecognizable to Henry Ford today. Of course, with the amount of computerization, automation, and just the way that the entire car industry has changed. You know, we're moving towards electric cars, right? The Lightning, completely different from what they had been doing, you know, 100 years ago at the Rouge. But the fact that it has been kind of stable, has been pumping out this industrial behemoth for that long is certainly interesting. It's certainly something that deserves a look. You know, we've gone from a factory that looked like this, which is, you know, this picture reminds me of like Zug Island, which still kind of looks purple like that, right? But this looks like, you know, Mordor, something from a fantasy world where it kind of looks, you know, evil and heavy and industrial. But now it's got a green roof, and you can actually go back to the Rouge, not too far, just a couple miles from this plant, a river that at one point was just uninhabitable. You couldn't go in the Rouge. It was a joke. It was a river that caught on fire. I used to take my lunch break and cross the Rouge River on this little bridge and go on a pleasant nature walk just a couple of miles away from the Rouge plant, walking back behind on some of the trails over by Fair Lane, Henry Ford's house. So it's a pretty amazing transformation, and in some ways we've kind of come full circle on that. So there's always more that we could say about the Rouge, but I've been talking for about an hour here, so I want to kind of wrap things up by again saying, if you haven't gone on some of those nature trails, if you haven't gone on a factory tour of the Rouge, I highly recommend both of them. They're really interesting to do, and it's certainly one of the most interesting things to take a look at. I also highly recommend Joseph Cabadas, I think is how you might say his last name, but he wrote a book. This is actually from 2004, And I use quite a few books for research, but this is a real gem. So if you want to know more about the Rouge, I can't recommend this one enough. It was a great resource in that way. But I do want to thank everyone for letting me come out to tell you a little bit about one of my favorite stories. I love early automotive history. I love the story of Henry Ford, and I think it's so interesting in what it does for our entire area. We all, I'm sure, have a connection to Ford, but again, I want to thank you all for letting me come out and just share a little bit of that story with you today.